So is Boyhood going to win it, Best Picture?
It's a good question. We were just talking about the fact...
Is it at least a conversation?
It's certainly in the conversation. It's certainly going to get nominated, I think. And it's an interesting... Because what is interesting about this festival is that nothing has emerged to go, okay, that's the movie that's going to kill Boyhood.
Yeah.
So there's still this sense that Boyhood has a very real shot. But there's always the sarcasm of whether IFC is going to spend enough money and...
IFC will.
...making it happen.
They will. They've made enough and they're going to spend it.
So does this feel more like one of your... Do all your children feel the same, or no. Do you...
In fact, I made the mistake of saying to Pete Hammond... Are we actually on?
We're now actually on.
You can say off the record if you want. I said to Pete Hammond, I was on the record. I said, I've worked on more than 600 films, and this is... And I said, this is by far the best. Which is probably a mistake. he asked me again. And I said, yes. And then he printed it. And then I got some phone calls, and I told all those people that what I really meant is theirs was the best.
Each of them was probably the best.
It's all progression. The next one will be better than Boyhood. Mm-hmm. It's like Ed Wood. It was a singular thing. You can't really compare it to other films because of the way it was made, and it is a film. Largely due to our friend Rick, where the actual execution outstrips the conceit. You know, mm-hmm. It's easy to say, wow, a film over 12 years, that's amazing. But as a stunt, that is remarkable to actually pull it off and get someone to finance it and do all that, but actually the film is better than the stunt. And that is a huge tribute.
So how has all this changed for you, having had relationships like the one you have with Rick over all these years? I mean, this must be a different... kind of work for you now than it was 15, 20 years ago?
My work in general?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, in my advancing age, I've sort of made the decision to try and do fewer things more deeply. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, I'm sort of picking the things that really move me, and I'm throwing myself into them to a greater extent. But I'm still a lawyer. I still have a law firm. I still see myself as a service provider. I took a producer credit on Boyhood because I felt that was appropriate, just as I did on I'm Not There, because it took me 5 years to get that film financed. But before that, I'd only thought that what I did was executive producing. So I think I'll probably do more producing and probably work with fewer people, but I'm still going to always be a service provider.
Will you become a more dominant force almost in the last number of years as the indie market has changed, it feels like? Is that...
You think so?
No?
I don't know.
Well, I think that, yes. Well, it feels like there are fewer people, there's like more of a concentration amongst the few of you who do the kind of things you do.
I mean, the agencies have somewhat effectively tried to sort of cut me out of my core business by aligning themselves to films at the financing stage. I don't love that. I don't think that credits the sort of craft of selling movies. I think it just puts them as a toll collector in connection to the movie. But, you know, they're smart people and they're good, and it's not like they're just throwing it out there. They're being strategic. So that's become more challenging, in fact. Mm-hmm. But the atomization, all the crazy change that is going on in the way content's made, the many ways it can be delivered, and the way it's being consumed, has probably made what I do more significant, because you need a traffic, person. What's the right word? Conductor, not conductor.
Cop.
Or someone to put all these things in order to optimize film. You know, if you've got 50 different ways you can sequence a movie and monetize it and get the most eyeballs on it, then you need people who know how to do that.
But I also think you need a guy with a club, you know, speaking of the same cop.
Yeah, but I don't have the same club as CAA and WME.
You don't?
I'd love to think I do, but I don't.
Did you? Do you think that you did?
Did I?
Because, I mean, that was kind of your rep also. I mean, people were scared of you. Who,
That's
me?
That's ridiculous. I don't know. I mean, I may hit harder, but the club's not as big.
Mm. So we're talking in all terms of sequencing and everything else. You've been pushing the agenda of opening up the VOD conversation and letting those numbers out.
Yes, I'm like my hero, Cy Sims. I think an educated consumer is the best customer.
Well, is it the consumer being everybody who not the real consumer, not the
it
not
could
the
be. End consumer. No, but it's filmmakers. It's what transparency, understanding. You know, it used to be for years I was pushing to get through Hollywood economics, you know, where there was no back end, and we started this company Indigent in 1999 dedicated to that idea, to promoting mm-hmm. transparency. So I think now the revenue streams have been simplified and rationalized, which attracts more smarter investors mm-hmm. who aren't just in it for the glam. And I think the idea of, you know, I mean, what I was promoting was something very simple, which was, let's create a metric for day and date releases that you can compare on an apples to apples basis with box office. It was really that simple. It's mm-hmm. like, if I say to a filmmaker, let's do this Magnolia deal, or this Radius deal, day and date, and they say, well, what's that going to do to box office, and will I make as much money? To be able to say to them, or to say to them, I don't actually know. It's just the distributor is telling me it's in the best interest of the film. Mm-hmm. It's kind of unempowering. If I can show them a bunch of films and say, this is a film that was released day and date, and though it had a box office that would invariably be lower than if it was a traditional release, it had revenue from transactional VOD when coupled with the box office that was greater than the box office would have been. Mm-hmm. That seems like an obvious thing to show an enlightened, you know, person, and it makes it easier for me to convince my filmmakers to go with a day-and-date model.
So with as many filmmakers as you work with, and as many films, why don't you have a chart, why don't you know that already, or are they avoiding?
Because it evolves on a daily basis. I mean, mm-hmm. the fact is the market's mutating, and we're trying to keep up with it, and we're trying to understand. I mean, I always gave the example of, and this is slightly, I mean, it's apropos of what we're talking about, like, I had two films at the same time. One was Elliot Spitzer documentary by mm-hmm. Alex Gibney, and the other was Freakonomics. Two documentaries, mm-hmm. vaguely similar subject matter, I would say. The Alex Gibney film did huge numbers on cable VOD and not very well on iTunes. You know, they came mm-hmm. out at the same time. Those are both transactional VOD platforms. Freakonomics did almost nothing on cable VOD and did huge numbers on iTunes. Mm. I mean, that's very interesting to me, and it's not necessarily intuitive. So, mm-hmm. so yes, we collect a lot of data, we analyze a lot of data, but we're just at the birth, we're at the nascency of that whole thing. And we're all, and I'm dedicated to making everybody learn as much as possible.
So, I mean, is there a reluctance for them to give up information?
Yes.
So that's still an issue. I mean, because that's like the traditional old thing about television, you know, when everybody starts suing, all the old TV stars started suing the studios for, you know, syndication information.
I mean, this sort of human penchant towards secrecy is just, you know, age old. I don't really understand it, and they have to give it to us eventually on accounting statements, as mm-hmm. you say. Talking to distributors and saying, I'd like to know how the film's doing, you know, VOD or something, and I say, you'll get the accounting statement, is completely maddening.
Yeah.
And they don't seem to understand that you've hired them to distribute your film. They didn't make the film. They may have paid you in advance, but really, you've hired them. They're doing a service for you, and they won't mm-hmm. tell you how the film's doing. I mean, it's ludicrous.
See, my argument on the other side of it that we've engaged in this a couple times is that I, from my side and the press side of it, the public nature of box office, I think more now than ever, actually, is kind of being misused and abused. And
by whom?
I think that the coverage of box office is now horrendous, and that there's a combination of publicity element that drives it, and of people who just aren't really that interested in box office, don't really understand box office, don't have any history of box office, and just kind of throw it out there and make these very competitive, you know, what's the top three, what's the top five, what's this one's doing better, why this one beat the hell out of this, and it's like the conversation becomes so dismissive of the films, and I think damaging to the films that aren't performed yeah. on the highest level that it becomes, I can only imagine with VOD it'd be even worse.
But the simple response to that is the answer to that to make the box office secret again, or to try and educate people to the full implications of the box office?
It's I not think to that make every, it if every again. Studio had a choice, they'd make it secret again.
Of course they would, but you look 25 years ago, nobody knew what, box office was a very parochial industry thing. Now everybody
knows. But is
that
good?
By Sunday night. Is it good? I mean, but that's...
I think it's a disaster.
Mean transparency's bad. It just means lack of education is bad.
Well, I think transparency for you is great. I think it should be required. I think it should be legal. I think it should be absolutely required.
Why is it? And you think
for
it's bad
the public, person? Because I think that the media has a tendency to use it in ways that are not helpful.
Right.
And actually diminish films that... are aspirational as opposed to the hit of the day.
I choose to trust the intelligence of the public. As to the irresponsibility of the press in characterizing it, that's something that has to be addressed.
Mm-hmm. Another thing to wrestle with. So do all these, is there a direction in all of these changes?
I think you and I disagree about that, though.
No, I just think we come from different angles. So, I mean, I believe you should know everything about your film. I don't think there's any question that any distributor should be giving you the information that day,
right.
Particularly in something like VOD where you actually have literal information and not kind of a estimate on Friday of what's going to happen on Sunday.
Yeah.
Whereas I think from the media side of it, even as somebody who has covered box office for a long time and loves it and is interested in it, I think the way it's handled these days by a wider and wider array of people is actually damaging.
Yeah, I take your point, and I guess I would choose to move in the direction of education. But you're right. I mean, what I want
journalists are too smart
to be educated. What I want this transparency for. I don't want the transparency necessarily for the public because I don't know what it means to the public. I mean, it's not going to make them watch more films on VOD. It's just, I want it for the industry. I want it to educate filmmakers. I want to educate financiers. That's what I'm interested in.
One theoretically would help Magnolia and help IFC and help those companies.
That's the crazy thing. And Radius, at least Tom Quinn is starting to understand that. Eamon and Jonathan Sarian and people like that don't seem to get that. I'm telling you, I said it will make it easier for me to persuade a filmmaker to do a day and date model if I can show him that that there's something that compensates for the depressed box office.
And since we're on the subject, is it fair enough? I mean, this summer we've had a few examples of movies that are from VOD companies, VOD-oriented companies that did not have a VOD, Boyhood being one of them, did not have a day-and-date VOD, and performed extraordinarily well at the box office.
But that's always been the case. I mean, Magnolia always, they did I Am Love, or is that what it's called? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The Tilda?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Tilda, they did that traditional, they do traditional windows, Radius will do traditional windows. I mean, just because you have that capability doesn't mean you always do it.
But do you see a glass ceiling in terms of VOD at this point? Is there a sense that there's a limit on theatrical because of VOD?
I don't know the answer to that. I mean, there's a glass ceiling that will expand, I mean, I think it's not, the tool is there, but the habit has to be created in terms of the consumer.
And do you see, I'm guessing you see each film that you do as an individual event as opposed to kind of this is what the indie business is doing right now, or this is what the year looked like, or whatever that...
Yeah, I mean, I guess I do. I think a lot of people are very excited about Boyhood because there hasn't been a lot to be excited about this year in terms of smart films, really working on a significant box office level. I mean, I guess... Chef did, and I haven't seen Chef, but I guess that's a pretty good film.
And Most Wanted Man.
And Wes's film.
Yeah.
But I guess it's getting harder. There are a lot of films. You look at Begin Again. Begin Again here last year was like going to be a $70 million film.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's 15. I haven't seen the Chris Rock film. I guess it would be interesting to see what's going to happen with that.
Well, is it how dependent is that on the distribution and the marketing, really, ultimately?
Well, did Harvey do a bad job on Begin Again?
I would say so.
Okay, I haven't seen.
He wouldn't like me to say so.
I haven't seen the film. That is certainly not his sweet spot, I can tell you that.
Yeah.
So.
Well, it's interesting because you don't have the connection to the distributors. There used to be this thing where you kind of had a sense of this is a Searchlight film, this is a Weinstein film, this is kind of where it belongs. And that seems to have dissipated as the money has changed. And
well, I've given up on that. I mean, I took The Kids Are All Right to Searchlight, and they didn't want it.
Mm.
You know, that was a Searchlight film.
Yeah.
So it's almost like the distributors don't want to be pigeonholed more as much as anything.
Mm.
It's interesting.
And are the challenging films getting more challenging? I remember a couple years ago, it was Ginger and Rosa, was it, that you were having?
Yeah. You mean on the films, or is the marketplace getting more challenging for them?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it is.
So even though there are more distributors...
I mean, there are 23 films released every weekend. It's ridiculous. You know, this whole pressure to release films theatrically, I think, is a huge problem. The idea that films only get reviewed if they're released theatrically. I mean, I think there's a lot taking place, a lot evolving, that certain areas are not getting in front of. And I think film criticism is one of them, actually.
Mm-hmm.
And I have this debate with the New York Times all the time, that they keep, you know, giving significant real estate to these films that they can't possibly affect. You know what I mean? And they write these, and then the films that they could actually write interesting essays about, that they could affect the result of, they oftentimes don't give the real estate to. You know, I had a huge feud with them over Exit Through the Gift Shop. You know, Exit Through the Gift Shop came out the same day as Date Night or something, and they wrote this scathing review of Date Night, and it did $100 million, and Exit Through the Gift Shop got a capsule review from a stringer, and it hurt it.
So you're still feeling the power of the local, certainly on a local level, the power of the critic still exists.
I mean, films without huge resources, it's kind of one of the only things you have. I had this debate with Owen Glyerman all the time. I said, why don't you pick the content that you find interesting, that you have something to say about, and that you can affect, whether it's a VOD, whether it premieres on VOD or premieres in theaters, rather than just, you know, artificially drawing this line at films that are released theatrically, because it forces films to be released theatrically in a really, you know, difficult economic model.
Mm.
You lose a lot of money releasing a film theatrically that doesn't work.
And how do they define what they could affect?
I think, like anything, you got to use your judgment. I mean, if you see
judgment, that's crazy.
Yeah, I know.
Well, I mean, we're in an era
as charged.
You can no longer actually ask Owen, because, or at least you can't ask about EW, because he's out the door, and they're only going to do the, you know, two giant films of the week, I guess.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. But, you know, by the same token, there's Grantland, and there's these outlets for people who actually want to write and for people who want to read. I mean, that gets to the question of whether the population is interested in reading film criticism.
And do you think they are?
I mean, it's almost like, you know, it's almost like the question about box office. I think people are as intelligent as they've ever been. I think they just sometimes get bad habits, and they need to get back in the habit. They need to be encouraged to get back in the habit. They need to be presented in a way that makes it attractive to them to get back in the habit.
Well, it seems like you almost need to market now to, on an independent film at least, to a smaller niche, or understand that you're not going to go after, you know, everybody.
Yeah.
Because you just can't financially, and you have to maximize the niche.
I mean, it's interesting. When we tested Boyhood, I don't know if I've told you this, but when we tested Boyhood, the quadrant that it tested best to was males under 25, which is this, you know, that's a terrifying fact, because the general rule of thumb is that you can't get to that group without spending $30 million.
Mm-hmm.
And so we immediately set to thinking about how we could get this experimental independent film to that audience. And it's hard, but it's not impossible. It's, you know, like any evolutionary situation, it challenges certain aspects and creates certain opportunities. I mean, social media is a way to market to specific, constituencies efficiently that didn't exist before. And it's evolving, but it's an awesome tool.
Well, you've kind of been through probably this era of your career has been through the most changes in a short period of time, probably of anybody. I mean, were probably at the beginning of the end of the VHS era was probably when you were starting out, yeah?
No, I was starting out before that.
Before that, even? You look so young.
You flatter me. I mean, the first film I sold was City of Hope in 1989. Mm. So, and I was an entertainment lawyer before that. But that was at the heart of the VHS era. That was when Larry Estes and what was the name of his company? I don't know. You know, when he financed Sex, Lies, and Videotape, it was right around the same time. Mm. You know, that was the muscle period for VHS.
It's also the first, that was the breakthrough year for sell-through VHS with Batman. That's what I always remember.
Was it really?
That was the year Batman was the first sell-through VHS, where they went to the $19 price point, the $20 price point, and sold in mass.
1989?
Yeah. Well, that's the year Batman came out that summer, and then by Thanksgiving, it was out in DVD on VHS.
Wow. Yeah.
That was, I mean, big landmark.
This is, yeah, the acceleration of everything. Like I said, the way, you know, television, the way people are consuming content, the way, you know, the atomization of all the windows and the way it's being delivered. I've never been in a period of greater accelerated change.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the technology keeps on shifting.
Yeah.
In this very dramatic way. Do you think that streaming is probably the end of it? Is there some other thing that we haven't thought of yet?
Yeah, it'll be implanted in your head, and it just comes in your eyes when you. I mean, if you spin it out and you say, what is the most efficient way to be flexible to view content? I guess we'll get there eventually, but streaming's pretty close to it.
Yeah, I'm a big believer in the subscription, the ultimate subscription model. That's going to be the once they crack this 40 million household thing. And get up to 80, 90 million households, that it's going to be, subscription's going to take over the universe.
Yeah, but is it just going to be Netflix?
No, Netflix will be one of five or six companies, yeah.
I agree. I mean, the way it's going to be, people are going to get to view films in public, they'll choose to view it in public or private, and then they'll choose, you know, paying for the consumption of that one thing, or subscription, or advertising, and that, mm-hmm. and those will be the choices. And if you're smart, you know, what they did with Snowpiercer was I think that should be the future. I think when you have something with inelastic demand, you put it, or scale, you put it in theaters for 2 weeks. All the people who have to see it or want to see it in public go do it. And then 2 weeks later, it's available at home. That way you get to draft off of the same marketing plan, which is a much greater efficiency, and you don't lose the people. I mean, you probably feel the same way I do, is that there are films that come out and it's like, yeah, I would like to watch that, but I'm not going to go to the theater to watch it. And by the time 4 months later it's available at home, you've moved on.
Well, the funny thing is, I feel like the Snowpiercer thing was kind of a car wreck. So,
do you really?
Yeah, there are people that there's certainly Weinstein
made
the position.
I haven't seen the film, but yeah, I guess Tom Brueggemann thinks it should have grossed $50 million.
Well, I think it could. I'm not a big fan of Tom Brueggemann's analysis, but I also think that movie was a, if it had been, you know, the thing is, Weinstein was never going to spend that kind of money, certainly during the summer, to make it a teenage boy movie, but it could have been a teenage boy movie, particularly in the soft summer.
So then why wouldn't they spend the money? Because they didn't agree with you?
I think they decided they didn't agree with us, and they didn't have the financial investment in the film that they needed to make it a requirement, and they could do okay on VOD, but I think that movie, it cost them money, ultimately, to not do a serious theatrical, because of the kind of movie it was. I mean, I think VOD is a great thing for independent film, and it required, you know, necessary to happen at this point, but I do also think that in that case, you had a pretty commercial movie with Captain America as your lead, and, you know, ironically, the core audience they found were film critics. You know, that's really? Like, for theatrical, they found adults. They never even, like, went after the kids.
And they could have had those kids.
And I think they could have had a good chunk of those kids. Because it's that kind of movie. It's a really exciting, you know, it was probably the best action movie of the summer.
Is that true?
Two or three, yeah.
Wow.
I mean, it's a really interesting, crazy film, so. But that's the thing, is ultimately somebody has to make that judgment and make that bet every time.
Yeah, but we're all getting smarter. You know, a good distributor would learn from that.
Yeah. So I'm fearful of everybody getting smarter. I mean, that's my argument about this summer in general.
Yeah, but that's crazy.
But I think the studio's figured it out. I mean, that's the story of the summer for me, is that there are 10 movies that cost over $150 million. All but one made over $500 million worldwide.
Yeah.
The only one that didn't made $430 or something like that.
Yeah.
And they're not going to lose money on any of them, probably.
But to me, that's a great thing. I mean, I was saying this 10 years ago. I said, I see the future. It's going to be, you know, the studios together are going to release 52 films a year. And then there's going to be one, each one will be given a weekend to just own the weekend, and then it'll play out. And maybe, you know, so that'll be some sequel or some action film, and mm-hmm. they'll every other week they'll do a rom-com, you know, an R-rated mm-hmm. rom-com or something, and then they'll do a kids film, and they'll leave all the rest of the stories to us. and we'll have to figure it out. And those models will evolve. And I think I'm fine with that, actually.
So you're okay with that as long as filmmakers can still make films?
Yeah. And I think all these things, and unless piracy puts us all out of business, which is the big argument for collapsing Windows, I think, then I think all these tools that are evolving only help us. The ability to market directly to audiences, to try and get to your audience without carpet bombing the media.
Mm-hmm. Well, somebody has to stop first, I guess.
Well, it's interesting. I was just talking about this in a meeting. The idea that in France you are not allowed to advertise films on TV is one of the greatest things ever, I think. And it makes the economic model of movies make sense. And it creates a meritocracy rather than one where you just buy people's awareness by, just bombing them. You can't do that here because we're America, but I love that notion.
Well, it's kind of the same argument against socialized medicine versus, the American system it had been, is that somehow you're not going to get the $150 million movies because if you can't carpet bomb and open to $100 million, then you can't, make the money with those movies.
But could you open to $100 million if nobody could carpet bomb?
No, that's a good question. Somebody's going to have to risk $200 million to find out.
No. That'll never happen unless they change the law. Because I mean, it's kind of like this thing. I went to Alan Horn when he was at Warner Brothers, an old friend of mine. And I said, why don't you, when you have something with complete inelastic demand like a Harry Potter, why don't you open it day and date in theaters at home for $150 a house? And you'll make $1 billion on your weekend, and you'll be good. And, I think the answer is if the theaters would let them do it on films like that, they would do it in a heartbeat.
Yeah. And I don't think you could charge $150, but I do think you could charge...
Why couldn't you charge $150?
Because people wouldn't pay it. People will not...
Bull.
People, why would they?
Because they'd have events. They'd have parties in their house, and it costs $150 to go out to see a movie anyway.
Well, it does if you live in Los Angeles or New York. It doesn't cost that if you live in the Midwest. I mean, that's the thing. It's not.
So then they see it in the movie theater. The point is, if you want to see it at home, and you have a bunch of kids, and you make that choice, and you invite some friends over, why not have that option? It's all, what's the difference? If you don't want to pay $150, then go to the movie theater.
Well, I think the difference is that, in that case, for instance, the only difference is really the bite that you get out of, because they actually get, their windows actually function for them.
Yeah, no, because they have to spend $50 million for the DVD release.
Yes, but they get a lot of money from DVD that they wouldn't get another post-theatrical.
I wonder whether if they collapsed that all and did it all in 2 weekends, they would make the same money.
Well, I'd be fascinated with the experiment. It's not my money, so
I think most studios would tell you they would do that.
Well, I think they all think it's a good idea. I think there's a notion of being afraid of what the outcome is, and the letting the Pandora out of the box.
They're afraid of the exhibitors. That's what they're afraid of.
You
know what I'm afraid of?
It is
piracy. That's what I'm afraid of.
But that is the end of distribution. I mean, if you do,
I don't agree with that.
If you start day and dating the big movies, or every movie really, why would they not? Why would, if they have Harry Potter, why wouldn't they do it with they're pre-selling other things? Why do you have, how many theaters? I mean, if the theatrical business goes down 20%, then half the theaters go away. So
I'm not sure that's such a bad thing. And I'm not sure most films need to be seen in theaters. Whether you delay it 2 weeks to get them or whether you create a theatrical experience. I mean, the things that should be seen in theaters are things that should be seen in theaters that are visceral, that benefit. I mean, nobody really believes that people have to go to theaters to see something in public because it's a nice experience. Most people are going to theaters now to see something visceral that benefits from that, or to have a nice evening where they can eat dinner, the whole Alamo Drafthouse thing. When you really challenge the theaters to make it an experience worth going to rather than just something that they're entitled to because people have to go to the movie theaters to see it, because that's the only way they can see it, then that will make them better at their game. And if they're thinking you just have to go to theaters to see it because that's the only place you can see it, then we're all screwed, because the average 19-year-old is just going to get resentful and he's going to go pirate it.
But wouldn't you rather go see Boyhood in a theater than watch it on your home entertainment system by yourself?
Would I? I mean, you can always find exceptions, and is that a film that benefits from public viewing? I don't know.
See, I would argue that any good film benefits from sitting in a theater and the experience
of... And I would say maybe you're a geezer.
But see, I don't think... But the irony is, I don't think it's the young people who are not going to the theater. It's ironically the older people who are harder to get into the theater. It takes weeks to get them to come out to the theater.
Yeah, but the young people... That, like I said, trying to get into Boyhood has been almost impossible. It's not hard to get them to the things that they should see in theaters, which are these big, visceral events. And then this idea of making it an evening... You know, like I said, this sort of Alamo Drafthouse, I mean, that is a great opportunity, you know? No one did it before because they didn't have to do it before because you had to go to the movie theater to see it. Now that you don't have to do it anymore, that it's going to make people actually create a better product.
See, I just see them as separate windows. I mean, I think they're all valuable things. I love the Alamo Drafthouse experience. I don't think I'd want to see a really fine film there the first time.
Because you don't like...
Because the experience servers, of the servers and the beer, even me eating during the movie... Is not a conduit to a great movie experience.
I mean, I got into the movie business for the popcorn.
Well, the popcorn, okay, well, popcorn's a little different, but I mean, even the experience of, like, iPick and those things, the high-end versions of Alamo Drafthouse, the distraction of, you know, ordering, getting another glass of wine or whatever is really taking you out of the experience of the movie.
You can always make that argument. I think that's a dangerous approach. I think that's anachronistic. I think that leads to extinction. I think you've got to adapt.
Maybe. We're going to find out. It's going to happen one way or the other.
I guess so, yeah.
Is there anything, do you feel like you've had a handle on what's coming over these years? Is it just keep on changing in such dramatic ways?
I think I've had as good a record as anyone in getting in front of it, but
none of us have that great a record. You just never know what's around the corner.
Someone said to me, it's like, I forget what the actual wording was. It's like things that you think, it's like things that happen in 10 years. Certain things that happen in 10 years happen in 2, but most things you think are happening in 2 years take 10 years or something like that. I've got to nail that one down because it was, when I heard it, it actually made perfect sense to me. Yeah, I mean, I was a partner in Pop.com in the late 1990s, which was an internet content site financed by Paul Allen. My partners were Steven Spielberg, Brian Grazer, Ron Howard, and Jeffrey Katzenberg, and it failed. I mean, I would have thought, how can something backed by that people with Paul Allen fail? Mm-hmm. And it was 10 years ahead of its time. So... You know, is now the right time for people to be in the habit of watching content streamed? Yeah, it sort of seems like it's getting there.
And you can order in Subway sub from Dive.
Is that the sub shop of choice?
That was the Steven Spielberg sub.
Oh, his sub, yeah.
Gourmet subs that kind of came and went.
Yeah. It did kind of come and go, right?
Yeah. It was tasty, but it was... Brick and mortar was a problem for them.
My favorite kind of food.
A good sub?
Yeah, good Italian sub. Forget about it.
Forget about it. Thank you so much.
My pleasure, as always.
As always.
All right, well.